I came to direct Lonesome Dove because I was the guy who could shoot a television schedule and give it a feature look, because they're quite different. We had 88 days to shoot Lonesome Dove, and that's probably a normal film schedule, and Lonesome Dove was four movies. I had not read the book, I had not even heard of the book. As soon as I read it, I thought, wow, this is a gem. It's a stunning adaptation. Probably, many people have said it's probably the best translation of a book ever to the screen in any form. And apart from a few extra bits we added from the book, not one word was changed from when it was, you know, locked off until when it was finished. Nothing was changed. Lonesome Dove in Texas even then was the Bible, you know, and when it was announced that an Australian was going to direct Lonesome Dove, oh my God, I felt like I had all Texas looking over my shoulder. But ironically, during the first week of shooting, or the second week of shooting, my film The Light Horseman was released and happened to have its premiere in Houston, Texas. And the headlines in the Houston Chronicle the next morning were, it's okay, Texas, you can relax. The guy that's doing Lonesome Dove knows what he's doing. It was quite racy for its time. Gus proposing to Lorena, how about a poke? It's pretty blunt, pretty basic. And I think, but because Gus is such a lovable character, I think, you know, people sort of bought it. And, you know, the whoring scenes are done all very tastefully. And it's nothing nothing's revealed that we didn't know about the West or anything like that. But it's just, I suppose it's more racy for television, not so much for movies. I met Bill Whitliff, who was my executive producer, who'd adapted Larry McMurtry's novel into a beautiful screenplay. I said this to Bill, and together we decided, along with Kerry White, the production designer, that all our information and research would just come out of old photographs from the old West. You know, the Western, particularly in television, had become bastardized in the 70s, you know, with cowboys and silly hats and waistcoats and jeans, and it just had nothing to do with the West. They were entertaining, but they had nothing to do with. And I wanted, you know, hot, dusty, dirty, sweaty, real, and because that's what the novel was. And I remember in the early days of filming, you know, someone, you know, ran into shot to pick up some horse poo, and I said, no, leave it there, you know, it's just, it didn't get picked up, you know. Lonesome Dove was a very tough shoot. Now, people said to me, oh, there's so many great sunsets and sunrises and beautiful scenes at the perfect time of day, and I said, look, that was just sheer luck. We started first light and we finished literally shooting the last shots against sky. In fact, there's one moment in at the end of night three where Danny Glover gets speared by the young Indian boy, and his death scene, and literally Dougie Milson, the DP, said to me, look, we've run out of light, we can't shoot the close-ups. And I said, no, look, if we just point up at the sky. And we did these last close-ups of Javale and Tommy Lee Jones, and there's these incredible pink clouds behind their heads, and just sheer accident. And people have remarked why the cattle looked so real and so good. They were scrawny corriente cattle from that we bought in Mexico, and I know the production made a profit on the cattle at the end because they were so well looked after. But we wanted this kind of scrawny look. Longhorns are hard to come by in great numbers, and corriente are very similar, and they kind of believably, these sort of Mexican cattle that which they've stolen to take all the way to Montana. There was a lot of luck. The most luck we had was there was a whole sequence of the cattle drive when they're driving through a blizzard and a snowstorm. It had started to sleet, and the wardrobe truck on the way to location needing to be first there, I guess, to set up base camp, and it jackknifed, and so all the crew trucks arrived behind it, and suddenly it started to really snow. I mean, just down it came. This was in the middle of May. And so the whole road was blocked. No one could get anywhere. And we've got horse trucks and cattle trucks and camera trucks. And so I went up to the nearest house, which was obviously a farm, and introduced myself and said, we're making this film called Lonesome Dove, and would they mind if we just shot on their property in the snow? Because all our trucks were stuck on the road. So they welcomed us, and they'd heard of the book Lonesome Dove, and we shot on this farm all day long, on this ranch, as they call it there, in this driving blizzard, and got these magic scenes. My favourite scene in Lonesome Dove, Robert Javale's death scene, Gus's death scene, when Woodrow comes in and meets the doctor, who leaves, and then they sit down and have this long discussion.
Well, I guess you're gonna want a fancy funeral too, ain't you?
I've been thinking of that. I have a favor to ask of you, and I'll do you a favor in return.
What favor?
I want you to bury me down yonder.
Yeah, the wardrobe was designed by Van Ramsey, but nothing worse than a hat wearing an actor. You have to have an actor wearing a hat. And so often you see a lot of these period dramas where hats are wearing actors just because they're correct for the period, but you just got to find something that suits the character, and because it says so much about a character in a Western, the particular hat. The network, again, were very nervous about the beginning because it was slow, but here were great characters that you were getting to know, and you just, the audience just had to give it time to sort of grow and develop, and they did. And I remember a lot of the early reviews, which were all glowing, said exactly that. Isn't it wonderful that it just doesn't start with a bang, that it just grows and grows, and all of a sudden you're sucked in by this world and these characters. I wanted it to be a big canvas, you know, to be wide shots, not just all close-ups. And look, it was all there on paper, and my job was to, you know, work with everybody to create the reality and to create an atmosphere on the set that was conducive to, you know, the performances of the actors. The only person that was attached to the project when I got involved was Robert Duvall, and he'd been approached to play Woodrow Call, the part that Tommy Lee Jones played. And I turned it down and said, look, I've played that guy, I want to play Gus. And he'd never done a role like that before. He was always known for these really hard-assed, tough sort of characters. He wanted to play this character, Augustus McRae, who's a character who just loves life, celebrates life, and he's a party guy. His doors and windows are wide open all the time, and Javal had never done that character before, and he still says it's the favorite character he's ever played.
Well, first man comes along that can read Latin is welcome to Rob, as far as I'm concerned. I'd like the chance to shoot at an educated man once in my life.
Tommy was a lot younger than the character he was playing, so and so is Bobby. I guess they're both sort of playing, you know, aging Texas, former Texas Rangers, and they each had an hour in the makeup chair every day before we started filming, you know, to age them. He's a great horseman, and he just loved every minute of being on that set and being that character. He was superb. They're two interesting characters to center the story on, and that's the genius of Larry McMurtry and the characters that he creates. Bobby Javal and Tommy Lee were both very good horsemen. So the main things you want is for them to be able to get on and off a horse, be able to walk up to a mark, etc., etc. But if you can get them all for 4 weeks beforehand, you can really get them. Most of them can become pretty accomplished. Not great, but good enough. And in fact, Ricky Schroeder had never been on a horse before, and he turned out to be a terrific rider. D.B. Sweeney who plays Dish, had never been on a horse before. It was the only thing that Tommy and I ever had a disagreement about, because he wanted to do a lot of his own more difficult, dangerous stunts, like the being thrown off the bucking horse and stuff like that. As I said to Tommy, the thing is, it's not that you're not capable of doing it, but if you break your arm, we don't have a movie. What does everyone else do? And we auditioned lots of unknowns who, of course, these days are really well known. We screen tested Julia Roberts, who was terrific, but maybe a little bit young and just too tall for Bobby Javal. And anyway, we ended up with Diane Lane, the most magic Lorena. Other people that read for that role, for example, and they were unheard of. In those days, there was Uma Thurman, Julianne Moore, Melissa Gilbert, Madeline Stowe, Nancy Travis, Mia Sara, Jennifer Jason Leigh. That's just, you know, some of the Lorenas that screen tested for us. Diane Lane is just everyone's ideal Lorena. She made the part her own right from the moment she got it.
I'm afraid I'm gonna lose you. I'm afraid you're gonna marry her.
Laura, you're working yourself into a sweat for nothing.
I don't think anyone can envisage anyone else as Lorena than Diane Lane. She, to me, was just perfect. She had the right vulnerability, the beauty, and just the ability as an actress to really win everybody's hearts. And she has some of the most moving moments in the series. A wonderful thing about Danny, he's a great reactor. You know, he can play a scene on his face even if he's not saying anything, because so much is going on, he's a great sort of listener. There's an interesting story behind Ricky Schroeder because his credit is Rick Schroeder. He turned 18 not long after we started shooting and became emancipated. In other words, he didn't have to have a parent on the set anymore. And he went as his journey in Lonesome Dove from a boy to a man during this cattle drive. And that was pretty much, Ricky had never done a film like this before. He'd never been on a horse before. He just loved it. He went from Ricky Schroeder to Rick Schroeder. Robert Urich as Jake made a wonderful Jake. You know, Jake was meant to be tall, dark and handsome. He was a ladies man, a gambler, a bit of a loose cannon. And Robert was very nervous about this role because it was something different for him. And I remember he was involved shooting before both Bobby Jival and Tommy Lee started. Some of the first scenes we shot were him being with the Suggs brothers and ambushing and stealing the horses and then killing the sodbusters. And he was obviously, as a character, very involved in all those scenes. And he kept ringing me at the end of the day saying, how was it? And after I saw his first lot of rushes, I said, relax, it's fantastic. It's exactly what we want. It's so spot on. Chris Cooper, totally unknown when he read for Lonesome Dove. He'd done one film for John Sayles called Mate One, but he made the audition his own, and despite so many great actors reading for July Johnson, Chris was the one that we loved the most. One of the problems we had was the television network, CBS, were insisting we use television actors, and we were just saying we're going to cast the best people for the part, whether the television or movie or whatever. And in fact, we ended up with a much more film movie cast, if you like, than a television cast. And one CBS executive remarked, this is CBS, not PBS. Nobody will know these movie actors. And they were very nervous about the miniseries because the Western was dead, the miniseries was dead. And in fact, when it first went to air, I'm told they didn't even sell all the advertising space, and the rest is history. It's just remarkable how it just took off from night one. When I finished my cut, we sent the cut to both Robert Jival and to Tommy Lee Jones out of respect. And Bobby had one note, and it was a very good note. It was to change his reaction in the hanging scene with Jake, because there was a better reaction, and he was absolutely right. For some reason, we'd missed it. And there's a magic moment when Jake spurs his horse, and the horse charges forward, and he's left swinging on Bobby's face. And he knew that there was a better moment that we had just somehow missed in the edit. And the one suggestion from Tommy Lee Jones was to use a more emotional take when he cries, when he finishes burying Gus at the end of his long journey back to Texas. And it was a take which was more emotional and showed tears, and I was reluctant to use, but he was right again. Sometimes you just get so close to the material you lose your judgment just a little bit. So they were both, you know, very good suggestions. I think All America cried when Gus died. I mean, restaurants, their business went down on night four of Lonesome Dove because everyone stayed home to watch. It just rated through the roof. One of the ten highest dramatic series of all times ever screened on US network television. I think it just struck a chord, and it was revived the Western to some extent. You know, it was nominated for an incredible 18 Emmy nominations. It was nominated in every single category there was. When we made Lonesome Dove, it was finished on film, and so when it was screened, it was actually projected in widescreen in a movie theater for, you know, critic screenings and for special screenings. And everybody said, oh, wow, why can't this be in a movie theater? Well, you know, now it is going to be presented in widescreen and in 5.1. The quality of the picture will now be so much better. Sound will be so much better. I mean, it just gives the film a whole new life.